We're Orbital and we're in the Duke of Wellington pub in Brighton. Stay tuned.
Chime was probably one of the easiest things I've ever recorded. It came out of sort of having a little bit of equipment. I used to record onto like a 6-input little Yamaha 4-track cassette, you know, recorder. And it occurred to me that, you know, so I always used to think in terms of 4 things, you know, a song could only have 4 elements. And then it occurred to me, oh, look, I've got 6 inputs. If I bypass the mechanism here and go straight into my dad's tape deck, which is what I used to do my mix downs onto, I can have 6 things. So quickly, I was going to the pub in a couple of hours, so I thought, right, knock something up quickly. Got, you know, sort of each instrument, 6 instruments, get something going, right, the sampler, you can do 2 things, you know, oh, look, there's a spare thing, what can we do? Let's do a weird sound, quick. It just got to a point where it's like, right, okay, there it is, there's the main thing, that sounds pretty good, it's all right. Throw in a 303, bashed out a quick kind of 7-minute jam, forgot about it, just, you know, probably listened to it when I got back from the pub and thought, that's all right. You know, and then sort of played it to Jazzy M in Ozone, who I used to go up and see, kind of used to be a bit of a mentor for me. I used to go up playing my demos and he'd go, what are you doing? You can't do that. Listen to it. And he'd go out in, he'd go out to his sort of record collection in the shop and just pick out a few things and go sort of give them to me, go take them home, listen to them. That's what you need to do, something like that, you know, and he'd kind of give me tips on what he thought was a good way for me to go doing sort of house music and dance music. He, you know, he was brilliant for that. But I played him Chime and he said, I'll have to listen to it on the headphones. And he put his headphones on, sat there looking at me. He started smiling. I kept smiling, started smiling even more. I thought, Jesus, what's going on here? And he sort of took the headphones off and went, fucking hell, I've got to play this out loud. And then sort of turned the record off and played it out loud. And I swear to you, nearly every one of those DJs that was lined up all went, oh yeah, put their hand up before it even really hit the main riff. And it's like, unbelievable. You know, I'd never seen anything, you know, like that. Just going from bedroom to all of a sudden, these 3 rows of professional DJs all putting their hands in the air to want to sort of buy this record. And he said, well, you can't buy it, but you will be able to in a couple of weeks, come back. And he was like jumping up and down. And that's when he basically sort of started his Ozone Records and made Chime within a couple of weeks. Totally took you by surprise. A few little things happened that probably could have given me an indication. I remember Jazzy M loading me up with white labels saying, you know, take these, see if you can sell them anywhere, you know, sell them on. Don't let them go for less than £2.30, you know. So I'd go off. And he gave me that 10. He said, oh yeah, I'll sell the rest of them, you know, to the, you know, the north of England or whatever. And I sort of went in, I remember going into the first shop I went into, it was Rounder Records in Brighton. And I said, oh, I've got these, do you interested in buying them? And the bloke said, oh, I'll get the manager down. He put it on, listened to it and went, how many you got? I said, 10. He said, oh, I'll take them all. You know, he said, £2.10. And I'm like, and then go for £2.30. And I said, no, £2.30. He said, no, I'm sorry, I couldn't take them. You know, and so I let him have them for £2.10. And I felt really cheated. But it's like, what I should have realised is, look, the bloke's buying all 10 of them. They don't normally buy 10 of things at that time. You know, that was a lot of records. And, you know, and I went back sort of to Jazzy M and said, I'd let them go for £2.10, but they all went to one place. He said, it's all right, I've sold the rest of them already. We're pressing up another 1,000, you know, in his eternally enthusiastic way. 909, borrowed Simmons Brain, S700 Akai sampler, 303, and the last thing, DX100. Solid bass preset.
Alesis sequencer.
And Alesis MMT8 sequencer, of course. Yeah, couldn't have done it without it. Baseline is the DX100 solid bass preset, which sort of like one of the favorites, you know, at the time. it kind of emerged around that time, around the sort of early 90s, that, you know, lots of people using it at the same time. Actually, the only place I kind of heard something like it was Big Fun, Kevin Saunderson, you know, Inner City. That was the only other place where I heard it. I thought, oh, it sounds a bit like Inner City, which actually I've since found out it isn't that sound. But anyway, sorry, the nerd in me coming out. But it's 303, doing the Roland bass line, you know, doing the acid the bass line. And the main, the main sounds are three samples.
Yeah.
From an easy listening record of my dad's, which I obviously can't reveal the source. And then you got the 909 doing the main bulk of the beat, with the four to the floor being a good old Simmons digital kick drum. I remember hearing Tears of a Clown by The Beat on the chart rundown on Sunday night in the bath, and just hearing that and just thinking, I want to do that. That just exploded in my head, and toys went out. You know, I didn't want to play with toys anymore. I just wanted to do music. I didn't know how that was going to happen. And it just kind of started from there, really. I was about 12, maybe 13. And I got a guitar, and my dad had a home organ. Used to use that for drums and bass accompaniments, and sort of multi-track that from playing tape recorders from one side of the room to the other. And then playing with bands, getting involved with some guys who did sort of more like a hippie band, a psychedelic band, and they had an SH-101. I used to just love fiddling with that and playing with their synth. As the 80s progressed, just getting into more and more kind of electronic industrial music and Cabaret Voltaire and bands like that, the guitar slowly slipped under the bed, and more technology came along, and the guitar pedals were used for putting drum machines through and things like that. When I started playing guitars, I was doing punk music. I was into sort of Crass and the Dead Kennedys and people like that. And so from 13 to sort of 16, actually even a bit more, I was playing in sort of local punk bands and garage bands and that kind of thing, sort of, you know, sort of a bit of psychobilly and that kind of thing. That, you know, once you've done that, that stays with you, doesn't it? And so with electronic music, you know, it was kind of going in that direction anyway. I always sort of liked things like Nine Inch Nails and the whole kind of industrial stuff, like Cabaret Voltaire, the Severed Heads are one of my favourite electronic bands, and New Order. And then kind of dance music came along, house music, and it was seemed to be a combination of sort of like electro and sort of high energy disco music mixed together. It was like, brilliant, two things that I love, and just kind of embraced that world. But taking in with it, every, you know, the sort of industrial element that was flowing along at the time anyway. Actually, I think we were quite immersed in it, in that scene, but it didn't seem like it, because to me, it'd been going on since about 87 is where I started to really feel things change from highbrow sort of tastemakers liking industrial music and you know, it's all that kind of industrial northern funk, like sort of Shack and Hula and all that kind of thing. And then all of a sudden you started feeling this sweep of house music. Okay, coming from Rare Groove and hip hop as well, you know, it, at the time it was all mixed together, sort of house music. You'd hear stuff like Public Enemy next to Nitro Deluxe and that kind of thing in nightclubs. And it was all sort of slowly coming together and forming, you know, dance music.
Lots of things going on. There was the Mutoid Waste parties, which
they were brilliant.
They'd have a punk band in one area, and then they'd have acid house in the corner somewhere else, and
hip hop somewhere else.
Yeah, lots of other.
So we were into all of that, and then Chime was done in late '89. Six record labels offered. I was still washing up in a pizzeria at the time. It was ridiculous. It was mad, wasn't it?
Six
lots of people all kind of vying for it. And, you know, we ended up going with Pete Tong and FFRR in the end. No, for me, in my naivety, it was like, well, you know, major label, more money, more facilities, more everything. Why not? Pete Tong seemed to know what he was talking about with dance music.
We were quite insistent on trying to be do an album, have an album, rather than just like, oh, we'll wait for the next dance, sort of 12 inch to come out, you know, weren't we?
And a major label is better for that, because we got an album's deal, like a 7 album deal, as like a proper artist, you know,
That's what we were pushing for, really, wasn't it?
Yeah.
At the time.
No, definitely. You know, because people were sceptical, like, well, an album, let's just do a few 12s and see how it goes, you know, whereas we was like, no, let's, can we have a career, please? You know?
Quite embarrassed, really, I think.
It was embarrassing.
To quite pretend into play, because it's not us at all, do you know what I mean?
It's one and only mine, wasn't it?
But, oh, God, it felt really awkward, do you know what I mean? And then there was a friend of a friend of someone that worked for the record company, a dancer came, you know, oh no, you've got to have a dancer there. She didn't really want to do it, we didn't really want to, you know, it was just like, oh.
Everyone had to do it, all single sort of keyboard wizards at the time. We were classed as a double keyboard wizard act, you know. You had to have a dancer. It was the top of the pops criteria, you know. Adamski, you know, if you look at him, he's got ballet dancers and, you know, everyone, every keyboard wizard from that era. That's a dancer on Top of the Pops. So they got something to focus on, you know. But it was great fun going into that studio. We were on with Snap the Power. What a tune to be on Top of the Pops with. Well, Glastonbury, though, 1994, I mean, I'd gone every year anyway since sort of 87 or something like that. And I could sense that there really wasn't enough dance music or electronic, you know, that current wave of music going on at Glastonbury. And it's 94 for crying out loud. It'd been going on properly since 88. And you'd had the Shaman, they went down well. And I saw the Orb in 93 and that was brilliant. When they did Little Fluffy Clouds, it just exploded and I just thought, poof. Well, this is what needs to happen, you know, this needs to happen here more often. And then we got the next year. You know, we'd had Bjork beforehand and M People, so it was kind of quite dancey anyway, but then we sort of flew on with full-on sort of techno and acid house. Perfect psychedelic experience for the other stage at Glastonbury, I think. You know, lovely weather. It was great.
I think for Glastonbury, though, it showed, you know, like that it could be successful, like two blokes up on stage twiddling knobs and pushing buttons. It sort of helped, you know, Mike Leavis and all that, you know, to go, oh, well, actually, oh, I get it now, sort of. It was almost a bit like that, or it felt a bit like that.
Well, he did watch it, didn't he?
Yeah, and sort of like, you know, and it's that time of night at Glastonbury where people just wanted it, you know, right, like at the end, do you know what I mean? It was like perfect.
That's the other one. No, it wasn't. Solid bass, DX100, solid bass all the way. Yeah, I think that Lately bass, I think, is another.
Why can't synthesizers be called Susan or like, you know, or Kaoli, you know, like get Daisy out, like, you know, yeah.
All of my different names.
It's the 50XO1030. Oh, yeah, that's right. Oh, yeah, that one.
I've got one called Macbeth.
Yeah, well, that's unique. No, it's called the M5 when we're on tour.
No, I love it because it's got, no matter what you do, you cannot avoid the word Macbeth on stage because he's got it emblazoned in huge great letters on the back of the synth. It's like, there it is on stage, Macbeth.
Oh,
bloody well say it because I just don't, I'm just not superstitious. So I love walking on stage, Macbeth, you know, it's like, fuck it, I don't care. The Macbeth M5N, that's one of my favourites.
Yeah, time travels as well. Got a special button on the back. 303. That's one of mine. And 101.
Definitely. Oberheim Expander. Another favourite. The best person I've seen is the. I'm going to get his name wrong. Giant Extinct Dinosaurs fella. What's his name?
Totally enormous
Extinct Dinosaurs. I think he did the best live show. I was watching him at Best of All. You know, I just like that he sings, he's playing stuff, he's doing his mixing. He's like, mate, you're doing everything. You could actually just stand out the front and be a singer and get someone else to do the technology. But no, he's like, he's in there doing it all like a one-man band. And he was working it and working the crowd. And it looked like he had a sense of freedom to it. Grimes, I thought she was pretty good. I saw her once. It's kind of quite crazy at times, quite sort of random, but I think that's what I quite liked about it, you know. She's quite similar actually as well, singing and doing the technology as well, you know. Fall, I'm at the moment spending time trying to, I'm trying to get into doing film scores and TV work. That's what I really do. I really enjoy that kind of thing. So I'm really want to, I've tried to do it before, but actually Orbital's always kept me so busy that, you know, thankfully, but I want to try and do some of that kind of thing. I love it.
I'm out and about DJing quite a lot actually, which is really good fun, really enjoy it. You know, really sort of keeps up my enthusiasm and sort of searching for records and stuff. It's really good.
Don't use presets would be the advice I'd give sort of young producers. You know, try and make your own sounds. I don't think it matters whether you do it on, you know, all this debate about analog synthesizers, you know, sort of in the box, out of the box and all that kind of, I don't care about any of that. But just buying endless reams of sounds by this person or that person and just using them. Try and make your own sounds.